in our IAP, as well as is very much interested in allergy and asthma disorders. Now I request Dr. Mantesh to speak on diaper dermatitis. Over to Mantesh.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the kind introduction. I thank the Central IAP, the IAP Tamil Nadu and Chennai branch for providing an opportunity to present this. So today I have a quite important topic, that is diaper dermatitis. So I thank Dr. Arun Inamdar sir for providing the wonderful slides for the presentation. Diaper dermatitis for pediatrician is very common and a very irritating problem actually. Whenever a child gets diarrhea, rather than diarrhea, the child will cry and fuss and wake the parents all the night, and parents will come to us saying that baby is not sleeping. More than the problem with diarrhea, they have problem with diaper rash and irritation and the pain. So it's most common problem we have witnessed in our day-to-day practice. So diaper dermatitis, what it is? So it is also called as napkin dermatitis or diaper rash. It is a non-specific term used to describe inflammatory reaction in the skin within the diaper area. The word diaper is included in the name, not because the diaper primarily. It's not, suppose a child is not, whenever a child with diarrhea comes with a diaper rash or diaper dermatitis, when you say it is diaper dermatitis to parents, the parents will argue that, sir, we have not used diaper only. How can it be diaper dermatitis? It doesn't mean that they have used diaper and caused dermatitis. It's basically the area, diaper area, whenever there is inflammation of the skin, we call it as diaper dermatitis, not related to use or not using diapers. So the dermatitis is associated with a combination of factors within the diapering area, including prolonged overhydration, friction, and the presence of irritants in the urine and the feces. So how common is the problem? It is very, very common. One of the most common forms of this irritant contact dermatitis, and it presents in over 20% of the pediatric dermatology visits. So especially dermatology. And for the pediatricians, very common association, especially whenever there is a child present with a diarrhea. So that's common age of 6 months to 9 months or 12 months. When the mouthing starts and there is a lot of diarrhea, that is a most common time we pediatricians get a lot of case of diaper dermatitis. It affects 7 to 35% of the general population, with the greatest incidence between ages 9 to 12 months. Maybe it is related to the diarrheal incidence and the skin maturation as well. And reaches peak at around 9 to 12 months of age. So what's the presentation? So diaper dermatitis presents as erythema and mild maceration of the buttocks, perianal area, genitals, inner thighs, and waistline, with sparing of the skin fold. This is very classical of diaper dermatitis, where it spares the skin folds, that is the concave areas. And in most cases, it is self-limited and resolves within 2 to 3 days. Diaper dermatitis is an irritant contact dermatitis. It's not an allergic contact dermatitis. It is an irritant contact dermatitis. It is caused by impairment of the skin barrier function, leading to inflammation, erythema, and occurs quite frequently in the young children, that is around 6 to 9 months of age. It is commonly associated with rapid and repeated wet and dry cycle. You wipe it with a wiper, again make it dry, again wipe. So other example is baby passes loose stools and urine, again clean, again it passes due to diarrhea. So this is one of the common reason for development of diaper dermatitis, that is rapid and repeated wet and dry cycles. And the other irritants are like saliva, urine, and feces becomes the most important irritants, especially associated with the diarrhea. And other irritants are soaps and various wipes. So classical presentation of diaper dermatitis, you can see only convex surfaces of the skins are involved. The concave surface is usually spared. So how does a diaper dermatitis develop? So initially there will be overhydration of the diaper area. Classical examples again in the case of diarrhea. So again, baby passes stools and again, and sometimes urine. So both will mix in a continuous overhydration of the diaper area. And upon that, you put some cloths or some diapers that lead to physical occlusion and again increase the moisture. And again, wiping with rough cloths and rough diapers leads to physical damage due to friction. And that leads to breakdown and maceration of the skin. And there will be injury to the stratum corneum and the epidermis. And skin becomes permeable to various irritants, especially which are present in the urine and fecal enzymes. So urinary ammonia, the urea which is broken down into ammonia by the bacteria present in the stool again leads to increased ammonia. Again, ammonia is an important irritant. So initially we thought that it is basically the ammoniacal dermatitis, this diaper dermatitis. People and few studies told it's basically due to the ammonia which is released from the urea by the bacteria present in feces, which leads to diaper dermatitis. But there are other reasons as well. So one of the important reason is ammonia, as well as also called as ammoniacal dermatitis in the, some studies. So this leads to various irritants leading to irritation, leading to irritant contact dermatitis. So what are the risk factors? The most common risk factors what we see is the diarrhea between the age group of 6 months to 9 months, which is the commonest age for presentation of this acute viral diarrheas. So other things are like the diapering practices of the parents. What are the feeding practices? So what wipes they're using, the wipes with alcohol, perfumes, and a lot of other irritants, and use of soaps. So as we already discussed, we need to use syndate soaps or syndate cleansing agents when you use normal soaps. So again, can be risk factors for development of irritant contact dermatitis. So other things are zinc and biotin deficiency becomes very important. So one of the treatable causes of these conditions. And one more is the premature babies whose skin is quite immature and can have a lot of diaper dermatitis. So what is the relation between breastfeeding and the diaper rash? So as always, we tell breastfeeding always helps the baby. In this case also, the study has shown that diaper dermatitis incidence is less in breastfed babies compared to the formula fed babies. And one more important thing is stools from the breastfed individuals have been shown to have a lower pH, that is acidic pH, which is good for the skin and may therefore be less irritating the skin. That's the reason behind why breastfeeding is advantageous, especially with relation to diaper dermatitis. And this always food allergy, whenever there is a persistent diaper dermatitis, one should think about this food allergen. So you treat with all those zinc, all those emollients and diaper dermatitis, still don't go even after 4 weeks. You should think of other causes like food allergies, zinc, biotin deficiencies like that. So elimination of food allergen brings the recovery from this persistent diaper dermatitis. And one more thing, important thing in food allergies, other than diaper dermatitis, these children with the food allergy have other constitution symptoms of, for example, gastrointestinal symptoms like feed intolerance, diarrhea, increased frequency of stooling, vomiting, irritability. These will be there in the food allergy. Other things are like skin rash will be there in food allergy other than diaper dermatitis. So in those scenarios, you should suspect food allergy as a cause. So other reasons for this persistent diaper dermatitis, as we told, the zinc deficiency, that is acrodermatitis enteropathica, is one of the important reason. Essential fatty acid deficiencies, other conditions like cystic fibrosis and Langerhans and cysticercosis are the other causes for persistent diaper dermatitis other than your food allergy. So differential diagnosis, this candidial infection is one of the important differential diagnosis. Blindly, most of us sometimes use the Candid cream or Candid B cream whenever the child presents with diaper area rash. So the important points to be noted in candidiasis is this satellite lesions. So you can see those satellite lesions, the classical of the candidiasis. In diaper dermatitis, there'll be plain erythema with some maceration. Whereas in candidiasis, you can see the satellite lesions, classical of the candidial infection. So one more differential diagnosis, though less common, is this flexural psoriasis, where you can see well-defined glazed red patches in the flexures. And the concave surface are involved in flexural psoriasis, whereas the diaper dermatitis, it is the only the convex areas which are involved. So how to prevent and what is the proper diapering practices? So what we have is this ABCD approach. A is air, the diaper area should be exposed to air. So how to use the barriers? So what is the cleaning practice you should use? And what are the diaper practices you should adopt to decrease the incidence of diaper dermatitis? And the education of the parents. So air is very important whenever you're treating the diaper dermatitis. The diaper area should be exposed to air as often as possible, especially when the child is having diarrhea. So it is better to not apply diapers. So though I understand that it will make the things a little bit dirty, so but as far as diaper dermatitis is concerned, so should keep the diaper area exposed to air as often as possible. You put the diaper for some time, again remove it, again put it. So you can do that. So this importance of exposing the diaper area to the air, which helps in keeping the area dry, and the child will have rapid recovery from the diaper dermatitis. So removing the diaper from extended period of time minimizes the friction as well as overhydration, it improves the fastness of the recovery. So barrier creams, what we use commonly as a zinc oxide cream or petroleum based products, provide a protective layer over the skin to reduce the contact with the urinary stool and allow the underlying skin to heal. One is it prevents the continuous ongoing irritation by forming a barrier function. That's why we say to the parents that whenever the child develops this diaper dermatitis or diaper rash, should apply the zinc oxide or this petroleum preparations very frequently. So as soon as they clean, again they should apply, rather than keeping it without the barriers. So should use this zinc oxide based creams very often whenever there is a child presents with a diaper dermatitis. Always a thick coat should be applied at each diaper change after gently removing the stool and other contaminants. And non-contaminated residual barrier cream does not have to be completely removed at each change. Only the soiled area need to be cleaned. Other the remaining cream, you can keep it there. So what barrier product should not be used? Cornstarch may be used to reduce the moisture and friction in diaper area, but should be used with the care to prevent inhalation. These days we are getting the baby powders with the cornstarch. So those can be used with the caution. They should not spray it. You should put it in a hand and apply it so that baby will not inhale that cornstarch. So this can be used, but cautiously. And whenever you advise baby powders, make sure that that contains cornstarch rather than this talcum. The baby powders containing talcum should be avoided due to concerns of asbestos contamination and increased risk of some malignancies. So make sure that the powder which we advise to the parents does not contain talcum, rather it contains cornstarch. Whenever advise powder, make sure that that will not lead to inhalation and problem to the baby. So how to cleanse it? The goal of cleansing is to completely remove the urine and stool while minimizing the friction. So don't with a rough cloth and with rough hand, don't scrub it. It should be very gently cleansed. If you doing it with a rough cloth and all, again it will increase the severity of diaper dermatitis. The skin should be cleansed with the water and sometimes the gentle cleansers. The products with the more acidic pH, that is around 5 to 5.1, may help to combat alkalization from fecal enzymes, which predispose first infants to diaper dermatitis. The bacteria which are there in the stool, they will multiply, and they are a very good time when there is alkaline pH. So you should offer acidic pH to the skin, that is around 5 to 5.5, which inhibits the growth of the organisms. So what diaper should be used and how often should be changed? Diaper change should be done as soon as the diaper is out. That's the first thing. So newborn should be changed approximately every 2 hours during the day, but older infants may only need a diaper change every 3 to 4 hours. As soon as diaperous salt, you should change. And sometimes you should change it and allow the diaper area to expose to air and again put it back. So it becomes really problem when the parents are traveling, especially in the long duration travels. So in those scenarios, there is increased chance of baby having the diaper dermatitis because of long usage of these diapers. So now most of the brands are now super absorbable, though they're costly. They tell they are the best diapers. These super absorbable and breathable disposable diapers, they minimize overhydration and decrease contact with irritants compared to reusable cloth diapers. And the study has shown that they decrease the incidence and severity of diaper dermatitis. So super absorbable. So what we see in the TV advertisements. So the thing which turns into gel whenever there is liquid is poured into the diaper. So that is a super absorbable diapers we are getting in our market these days. And most important is the education to the parents. So diaper dermatitis is a preventable condition, especially when you witness a child with diarrhea. So you should warn the parents regarding the chance of baby developing this diaper dermatitis. And it is advisable that whenever the child develops diarrhea, they should be using this barrier zinc oxide creams before the child develops this diaper dermatitis. That is a breakfast practice. Rather than allowing the child to develop diaper dermatitis and a lot of pain and irritation, and it will cause irritation to the parents as well as to the treating doctors. So education of parents is very important. And proper diaper hygiene techniques should be taught. Like caretakers should wash their hands before and after applying each diaper to prevent any bacterial contamination. And when they are cleaning diaper area, wiping should be done from front to the back. If they are doing from back to the front, they are bringing all the bacteria from the anal area into the front. So it's always wiping should be done from front to the back. And they should avoid soaps. And if they are using soaps, the Sindet soaps are better, or these liquid cleanser, they say they are the best. And they should avoid abrasive scrubbing of the skin whenever there is a soiling. So they need to remove the soiled area. Sometimes they keep on scrubbing that area. That leads to, again, the severe forms of diaper dermatitis. How to prevent and intervene the occurrence of this diaper dermatitis? The prolonged and excessive humidity with friction. So what to do for this is to do a frequent diaper change, and you can use super absorbent diapers which are available these days. So alkaline urine and feces, so which are one of the important reasons for the child to develop diaper dermatitis in those scenarios. So you can use super absorbent diapers, cleansing with wipes which doesn't contain any fragrances or any irritants or alcohol. So, or it can use the cotton wool and water. It can use topical emollient and educate the parents to take off the diaper as soon as it is soiled. So what are the cleansing agents to be used? Cleaning using soap and detergent should be avoided. So do not use soaps and detergent. Even they say do not use any chemicals like Dettol and all to clean these cloth diapers whenever and undergarments. So many of the parents, they want to protect their kids from this bacteria. So in the previous talk, we heard about this microbiome. So these chemicals are definitely going to affect the microbiome of the skin. And you should discourage the parents from using any chemicals like Dettol and all these things, even for washing of the clothes. So these are the points to improve the recovery and to prevent the occurrence of diaper dermatitis. So the aim is to accelerate the healing and prevent the occurrence or recurrence of the rash. So topical preparations like zinc oxide preparation, petroleum, there are some preparations with vitamin D and vitamin A. And whenever there is an erosive diaper dermatitis, which has a lot of pain, one can use this topical sucralfate. There are various preparations with aloe vera, lanolin, and mineral oils. Whenever you suspect candidal infection, you can use the antifungals. And sometimes prolonged diaper dermatitis can have this bacterial overgrowth. In those scenarios, you can use antibacterial, topical, or oral antibiotics. You should avoid the things containing talc, boric powder, camphor, phenol, benzocaine, and salicylates. So these things tend to aggravate. And even the topical polysterol has some effect, especially when there is high output stools and the child is having some malabsorption, all those things. We can use this topical polysterol for patient as well. So what to do about this diapers, whether to use super absorbent polymer or the cloth diapers. So as studies have shown, super absorbent polymer diapers are the best, but due to socioeconomic conditions of the parents, one can use the cloth diapers. So, but make sure that they should wash that cloth diapers on the both the sides to remove any the irritant which is there on the cloth. And they should apply this barrier zinc oxide cream very often, and they should not use any rough cloths whenever they're using the cloth diapers. So whenever the parent has, you can definitely sell super absorbent polymer diapers are best, but in certain conditions when they cannot buy due to high cost, cloth diapers can be used with a caution, and no chemicals or very harsh detergents to clean those cloth diapers. The super absorbent polymer diapers, they have cross-linked sodium polyacrylate in them. In the diaper core, it forms a gel when they come in contact with any liquid like urine, resulting in a reduced skin or hydration and friction, and that helps to normalize the skin pH. And we have seen in the advertisement, so you put the diaper in the evening or night, till the morning, baby will be all fine. So this is the classical of this super absorbent polymer. They have the capacity to absorb the liquid multiple times. So that's advantage of this. But again, so the skin should be exposed to the air in between, that's important. So the current evidence suggests that super absorbent diapers and barrier creams are effective for prevention and treatment of dermatitis. There is a lack of data supporting superaerative wipes or water or vice versa. So you can use water to wash and sometimes wipes, but make sure that wipes does not contain these alcohol preparations or any antibacterial things or any irritants and fragrances. The plain wipes and water, they can be used to clean the diaper areas. So modern disposable diaper technology has successfully reduced some of the main negative impacts of overhydration and this alkaline pH and friction and other variables on skin integrity. So the super absorbable diapers definitely have an important role in prevention of the dermatitis, especially when the child is having diarrhea. There is one study using emollient containing diapers and pH buffered by regimen, saying restores skin pH and reduces skin enzymatic activity. The conclusion of the result suggested that use of an emollient containing diaper with pH buffered wipe creates a condition favorable to optimum diaper skin health. But definitely when you use the emollient containing diaper with pH buffered things, the cost is going to definitely increase. So only when the cost is low can advise these things. So take home messages are this: urine and feces, especially when the child develops diarrhea, are the important irritating factors. The bacteria in the stool, the ammonia released from the urine are the important irritants. The overhydration, the warmth, the increased pH by the bacteria are the reason behind the microbial proliferation. So what we do an ABCD approach: expose the area to air, use barriers, so advise on how to clean, how to use the diaper, and educate the parents regarding how to prevent the recurrence or occurrence of the diarrhea and how to hasten the recovery from diaper dermatitis. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mahintesh, for an excellent talk on diaper dermatitis and the proper use of diapers and which one is the best one for managing diaper dermatitis. I think you can stop sharing.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. So now.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, sir.
It's my pleasant duty to introduce you, the national coordinator of IAP Derma module, to give the talk on fever with rash. I feel privileged to introduce Dr. Vinod Ratagiri, who has been with you all this time, coordinating all the speakers. He has qualified for